Dear friends in Christ, grace and peace to you from God our Father and from our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Anybody here last Sunday evening watch the Academy Awards? You can raise your hand, go ahead. Wasn't that kind of crazy at the end of the Academy Awards when there was that mix-up of who really won Best Picture? I felt sorry for Warren Beatty. He didn't know that he had been given the wrong envelope, and so he had the envelope from the award before, and it said La La Land on it and Emma Stone, and he didn't know quite what to do, so he showed it to Faye Dunaway, and she looked at it, and she said, La La Land, and La La Land really wasn't the winner. Moonlight was the winner. It was this awful mix-up. In case you didn't see it, just take a look.
Guys, I'm sorry.
No, there's a mistake. Moonlight, you guys won Best Picture.
For Best Picture.
You're awesome. Come on. La La Land.
Come on, this is not a joke.
This is not a joke. I'm afraid they read the wrong thing.
This is not a joke. Moonlight has won Best Picture. Moonlight, Best Picture.
All right, terrible mistake, right? Terrible mistake. PricewaterhouseCoopers, the company in charge of the sealed envelopes, you know what I heard? I've heard that they've done this for many, many years and that they have been giving out envelopes and giving out the sealed envelopes for a long time. They've taken full responsibility for the big mistake. But you know what? They've done it for so many years now that they have handed out, this is the number that I heard, they've handed out 28,833 envelopes in their time, and they have never once made a mistake. Not once out of 28,833, and now they make a mistake for the first time in almost 29,000 times, and they're getting crucified. Do you know that the two reps that were there from PricewaterhouseCoopers have received, and this is awful, they have received death threats over the mistake that they made first time in 29,000 times. Anybody here ever make a mistake? Raise your hand if you have. Anybody here, one out of 29,000, or have you made more mistakes than that? Anybody here perfect? Raise your hand. Nobody here perfect? Gloria Day, come on. I thought we had some perfect people here. Of course not. We all make mistakes. We all make mistakes, and we blow it. We live in a world and society, I think, that so many people are quick to judge. One mistake in 28,833 times, and they're getting death threats. We live in a society that is so quick to point fingers and to judge. But thank God that it is different with the God that we have. Psalm 145, verse 8, is one of my favorite verses in all of Scripture. And it says this, "The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love." Let's see that up on the screen and let's say it together. The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. That is a verse that you, if you haven't memorized it, should memorize it. And when you make mistakes, because you will and I will, it's important for us to know that the Lord is gracious, the Lord is merciful, He is abounding in steadfast love, that God is slow to anger. This past Tuesday, Gloria Day hosted the funeral for Kareem Sisi. Kareem was the 15-year-old Washington High School student who died in a car accident about a week and a half ago. Mistakes were made. Illegal drugs were involved. Stealing, a high-speed chase, lots of mistakes, and unfortunately, tragically, what could have been and what should have been avoided ended in Kareem's death. And now other young men are sitting in jail, facing serious charges. We live in a world where we know, when we're honest with ourselves, that when bad choices are made, when mistakes happen, that there are consequences. And in this case, there were some tragic, tragic consequences. In the Bible, there is a pattern, and it's a pattern that you know because you live it every day, but there's a pattern that runs in Scripture from the very beginning in Genesis all the way to the end of Revelation, and that pattern is this, and it's important for us because it applies to our lives. It is this: there is sin. In other words, there are mistakes made by every single one of us. Then there are consequences. In other words, there is, sometimes the Bible calls it judgment. Sin, consequences, but then always, 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 it ends in grace. It ends in grace. Sin, consequences, grace. Say that with me. Sin, consequences, grace. That's, we see it from the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve are there, right? They make a mistake, they disobey God, they eat the forbidden fruit, and what happens? There are consequences. God ushers them out of the garden, he ushers them out of this perfect world in which they live. Consequences, but then there is grace. There is always grace. God says, the shame that you are feeling because of your disobedience, I will clothe you. That is a way of saying that God says, I'm never going to leave you alone. I'm never going to abandon you. I'm going to take care of you. Sin, consequences, and grace. We see it through Cain and Abel, through Noah and the flood, through the Tower of Babel, through the call of Abraham and Sarah, all the way through Scripture. And you know, I've done some good things in my life, but I've also must have made some mistakes. I've made a lot of mistakes. As a father, I've made mistakes as a husband. I've made mistakes, God knows, as a pastor. And when I make mistakes, I know it and I feel it. And when you make mistakes, most of the time you know it and you feel it. Sometimes we, most of the time, we are our own worst critics. We are our own worst enemies. And so we kind of lay it on ourselves. How could I have done that? How could I have made that mistake? So, do you know what I need? Do you know what you need in those times? I need, and you need, not more heavy-handed law. I need a word of grace. I need a word of forgiveness. That's how marriages keep moving forward. That's how congregations stay healthy, with a word of grace, with a word of forgiveness, with a word of let's move on together. I was able to speak with Kareem's parents at length. I've been able to speak with the driver of that car, who's now facing serious charges. He is a 4-year active member of our youth group here at Gloria Day. I've spoken with his attorney. Every single person involved in that terrible, terrible circumstance and accident know, believe me, that they made bad choices. And they are being hit hard with the consequences. They are beating themselves up with the law. So what in this instance do you think they need to hear the most? Grace. They need to hear a word of grace. They need to hear a word of love. They need to hear that God has not let them go, that God has not abandoned him, and that's what we need to hear always too. It's what you need, what I need, what this world needs. And our sermon series during these weekends of Lent is called the God of Second Chances. In other words, a God who can and a God who does bring about life and transformation amidst all the stuff around us, the stuff of sin and death. We heard read today the story of Saul turned into Paul. Saul was a first century Pharisee. He was probably around 25 years old when Jesus was crucified. And as you know, he was a violent persecutor of the early Christian faith. In Acts chapter 7, just a couple chapters before we get to Acts 9, Saul is standing there and he is no doubt cheering when Stephen, the first Christian martyr, is stoned to death. Imagine dying that way, that somebody, that a mob of people throw rocks at you, throw stones at you, till you're on the ground and you die. And Saul is standing there holding the coats, no doubt cheering them on, because Saul was that kind of person. He had a rigid, rule-based religion, and it said that Stephen was wrong for proclaiming Christ, and they killed him. That's Saul. And so on the road to Damascus, it's about a 5 to 7 day journey from where Saul was, together with this band of thugs that he had with him and their list of names of Christians, people of the way, that he was going to go after. to either kill them or put them in prison, the risen Jesus shows up in a very powerful and real way. And he knocks Saul to the ground. And Jesus yells out, "Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? Why are you doing this? Why are you so violent against my people?" This is God speaking. This is the Son of God talking. And I want to show you a different way. I want to show you a way of love, a way of forgiveness, because that's what I have in my heart. That's why I died for the sake of this world, out of love and compassion and forgiveness. So Saul, I'm going to put you on a detour, the detour of your life, and your heart is going to be changed. And long story short, Saul, this young man with terroristic actions towards Christians, is renamed Paul, and he is baptized, and he is converted, and aside from Jesus himself, he becomes probably the most influential person and missionary that Christianity has ever known. It is an amazing transformation, and do you know how it happened? It happened through grace. It happened through God's grace. It didn't happen through hammering the law on Saul. It happened through a word of grace and love and compassion from God to him. He was radically changed. But you know what? It's not just for Paul. It's for you too. And it's for me too. It's possible today in our lives. And I want to, as I kind of wrap this up today, quickly take a look at three ways in which I see God working not only on Saul in our scripture passage, but also how God works on you and me today. For all of us who make mistakes. Number one is this. Saul met Jesus. Saul met Jesus. Not some kind of idea of Jesus, but Saul met the real Jesus. He met the biblical Jesus, the one who was revealed in Scripture. That is the Jesus that you need to know. This world, people grab hold of Jesus for all kinds of agendas and for all kinds of propaganda. That's not the Jesus you and I need to know. You need to know the Jesus who is revealed in Scripture. The one who says, "I love you." The one who says, "I went to the way of the cross for you." The one who says, "I want your life. I want your whole life. I want to be Lord and master of your life. I want to be the pilot flying the plane of your life. I want you to hand it all over to me. Not just part of it, but all of it." And Jesus says, "I want to be Lord of your life because I have pure motives. Nobody else in the whole world has pure motives except me," Jesus says. "So let me run your life. Give it over, all of it, and get in on the adventure of your life." That's the Jesus that we meet in Scripture, that you meet here every time you come and the word is proclaimed and the sacrament is shared. Jesus, the one who says, "I want to set your life in a new direction. I want to make your life the adventure that you always thought it could be." It's that Jesus who meets us here with power. So don't ever underestimate the power of this Jesus. He is more powerful than any other human being on this planet. And he wants your life. He wants to give you life. So stop playing it safe and take a risk and jump in with Christ 100% and let him take you on the adventure of real and abundant life. So number one, Saul met this Jesus and it radically changed him. Number two, Saul Paul got a new vision. The Bible says that as Ananias prayed over him, something like scales fell from the eyes of Saul. And all of a sudden, he maybe saw the same things, but he saw everything in a new way. He saw this world in a new way. He had a new vision for the world. He had a new worldview. His heart was changed. No longer did Saul want to hurt and kill people who saw things different from him. He wanted instead now, with his heart of compassion and love, to share Jesus with them, not to hurt them, but to give them the life that he knows can be found in Christ. His heart was changed. He wrote, you know, much of the New Testament. His heart was changed, and so he was able to write things like these verses that you know so well, Ephesians, "By grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, but it is a gift of God that comes right from Paul." Ephesians 4:13, "I can do all things." Philippians 4:13, I'm going to get it right. "I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me." Or Philippians 4, which is one of my favorites. We started worship with it. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice. This comes from Saul turned Paul. Why? Because his heart was changed. 1 Corinthians 13, faith, hope, and love abide these three, and the greatest of these is love. So like Paul, tell God. Tell God that you're sorry for your unrighteous anger, that you're sorry for the bitterness that you carry around in your heart, that you're sorry for your heart that is way too quick to judge. And I do the same thing. Tell God to take away your fear. Tell God to fill you with faith, to give you a new vision, to give you a new worldview, a new heart. Pray often and always for those fruits of the Spirit that Paul knew so well and that he wrote about, things like love and joy and peace and patience and kindness and gentleness and generosity and self-control. God loves you. He will give these things to you. He will change your life, transform you into a new being through Jesus Christ. And finally, number three, Saul turned Paul, was baptized, and he received the Holy Spirit. Now, I know this is maybe where you check out. This is where a lot of people check out. Well, preacher boy, it's okay for Paul and for people like Mother Teresa and people maybe like Billy Graham to have the Holy Spirit upon them, but me? Really? Me, the Holy Spirit? God can't do that for me. I don't even know much about the Holy Spirit. Well, hear me on this. Yes. Yes. 1,000 times yes. Yes, God puts his Holy Spirit upon you in baptism, and it doesn't leave. And you pray every single day, God, you ignite that fire within me. You ignite that Holy Spirit within me, and you use me just like you did Paul to be an agent of grace in this world, because that's what this world needs to hear. You are an agent of grace. So pray for it. I had a couple come up to me after worship a few weeks ago. And you know what they said to me? They said, Pastor Tim, it is so awesome. Our marriage is getting new life. They were so excited. They said, God is filling us up. We're so inspired by the music, by the Word of God proclaimed at Gloria Day. We're digging into the Word at home, and God is changing us. We're seeing incredible changes in our lives and in our marriage. And the man said, you know what? It's like I'm a new person. I'm a new man. And the wife agreed. She said, yeah, he was worse than me. He needed it. And he said, you know what? I did. I was a lousy husband. But you know what? God's working on me. He's changing me. He's changing my life from the inside out. You know what was happening? The Holy Spirit was changing that man and that couple's hearts. On Tuesday at Kareem's funeral, I saw God working. I saw so many people being used by the Holy Spirit as agents of grace. A man I didn't even know came up to me after the funeral, and he said, Pastor, I want to thank you so much, and I want to thank Gloria Day, all of you, for opening up its space to the Baptist Church, where the CCs are members, so that they could have their funeral here at Gloria Day. He said, I know how denominations are sometimes, and that's not always the easiest thing to do. So what you've done is to show and to be a sign of unity that we share in Jesus Christ. And I said, amen to that. And I saw a Baptist preacher and heard a Baptist preacher right up here with hundreds of high school students and over 700 people here, black and white, together hearing God's word. God used him as an agent of grace. And I saw all of them being agents of grace as well, as they were supporting one another, as they were crying together, and they spent hours out in the gathering area afterwards supporting one another and supporting the family. And our Gloria Day volunteers and staff and all that were here, the kitchen crew, all of you who were part of that, the Holy Spirit filled you. But that's just one example. The Holy Spirit fills this congregation in a multitude of ways as we open ourselves up, all of us, to God's work through the Holy Spirit in being agents of grace. I am so proud to be a part of this congregation. And I saw Kareem's parents also reach out, not in anger, which they very well could be doing, but they reached out in compassion to the other boys who were involved in that accident, agents of grace. It's tragic events, tragic consequences, but even for Kareem, We can say that grace wins, that God wins. Even in death, we have the promise of sure and certain hope in Jesus Christ that he brings us to life, even amidst the sorrows of our life. And then finally, Tuesday night after the funeral, after a hard-fought basketball game between rivals Lincoln and Washington High School, it was a 2-point margin. I think Lincoln ended up winning that game by 2 points, so it was a tight game in the playoffs. Much of the student body just kind of spilled out onto the court, onto center court, to gather and have a prayer for Kareem. Let's take a look up there. Here's a picture of what happened. And they all gathered, and they were all involved in a prayer. And the prayer was led actually by one of our Gloria Day youth. It was an amazing witness to the power of the Holy Spirit working in and through high school students, through all of us, to be agents of grace. So don't you ever, ever, ever think that God cannot and will not use you for the kingdom of God, because he does. The Holy Spirit is with you now and always, and continue to pray that that Spirit will be ignited. Sin? Yes, all of us, every single one. We stand equal at the foot of the cross. Consequences? Absolutely. God's law is not bad. God's law is good, and the law is necessary. But the law never saves. The law doesn't have the power to save. What saves is the gospel of Jesus Christ, and that's what this world, that is so often so quick to point fingers, that's what this world needs to hear. God's love, God's grace, God's forgiveness. You see, the power of God's grace is way more powerful than my mistakes or yours. It's what I need, it's what you need, it's what this world needs, and it is found fully, fully in Jesus Christ. So go from here today knowing that you are loved, that you are forgiven, and that you are turned around, that you are given a detour of life to be an agent of grace, receiving it and sharing it in Christ's name. Can I get an amen? Amen. Amen.